Hello everyone, I'm really happy to share this presentation with you. So I'm Aurore Thibault. I've been working at the Common Sense Group for the past 10 years. So as you know, the Common Sense Group was created by Professor Steven Reis, and now I have the privilege to co-direct the lab with my colleague Olivia Gosselin. And as you can understand from the title of this presentation, the non-invasive brain stimulation in patients with disorder of consciousness, I'm really passionate about how non-invasive brain stimulation can stimulate brain activity and as a consequence, potentially improve the recovery of those patients with severe brain injury. So to begin the presentation, I will first introduce how we clinically assess patients with disorder of consciousness, and I will go through the clinical definitions. So all those patients with a disorder of consciousness, they go through a period of coma, and during that period of time, those patients, they cannot open their eyes, and they only present reflexive behaviors, such as, for instance, flexion when they receive a painful stimulation, but they really do not present any purposeful behaviors. This state, the coma, only lasts a few hours, sometimes a few days, but it never lasts forever. All the patients would at least recover to the unresponsive wakefulness syndrome. So the unresponsive wakefulness syndrome, or UWS, previously called the vegetative state, VS. So in this state, the patient, they recovered eyes opening, but they still do not express any purposeful behaviors. So they only present reflexes. This state can last for a few days, a few weeks, but it can also last for like years. So some patients will stay in this state forever. Then some patients will recover some slight signs of consciousness. And this is what we call the minimally conscious state. So the patient, they can open the eyes and they present non-reflexive behaviors. The behaviors could be, for instance, command following, and this is categorized as minimally conscious state plus, as the patient presents language-related behaviors. And other present, for instance, visual pursuit or object localization or localization to noxious stimulation. And this is what we call the minimally conscious state minus. But what is really important to understand here is that all of those patients, they cannot communicate. So we cannot really interact with them, meaning that it's really complicated when it comes to rehabilitation and therapeutic strategies, because we have no interaction with them. We cannot ask them to be really active in their rehabilitation strategy. So this is really a key point, especially for the treatment. When a patient recovers a functional communication or a functional use of object, we say that they emerge from the minimally conscious state. So they are not in a disorder of consciousness anymore. And so also an important point here is that now, thanks to the development of neuroimaging, we notice that a proportion of patients who are unresponsive at the bedside. So those patients, they open the eyes, but they do not express any signs of consciousness. So they are unresponsive. Some of them present a brain activity that is more compatible with the minimally conscious state or even with LC control. And this is what we call MCS star. So that's patients who are behaviorally unresponsive, but their brain activity demonstrates some residual activity which is closer to what we observe in a minimally conscious state or even more. Another term is the CMD, so cognitive motor dissociation. So it's really important to understand that really a proportion of patients who are unresponsive at the bedside or really seen as unconscious actually might be conscious but unable to express it. So the absence of proof is not the proof of absence. So it's really important to use sensitive tools to evaluate those patients, and the most sensitive one is the Coma Recovery Scale Revised. This is a scale you see here, and this is, as I said, the most sensitive one, and it's the only scale that assesses all the criteria for the minimally conscious state. The criteria you see with a little star here. The scale encompasses 6 subscales and require sometimes to apply it. Most of the time it takes between 20 to 30 minutes to perform the scale, which may be a limitation because it takes some time to do it. So why is it so important to provide an accurate diagnosis? So if we don't use a sensitive scale as the Coma Recovery Scale Revised, for instance, there is a misdiagnosis rate of about 40%. So for instance, if you use a Glasgow Coma Scale, which is the scale that is used most of the time, especially in the intensive care, you really may miss some signs of consciousness. And it has really critical implications for the prognosis, the therapeutics also, and obviously ethical implication as well. So here you see in terms of prognosis, between a patient who is unresponsive, 1 month post injury, compared to a patient who is in minimally conscious state, 1 month post injury, you see in green way higher chances of recovery for the patient who is in minimally conconscious state compared to unresponsive wakefulness syndrome. There is almost no patient who emerged. While here, most of the patients in unresponsive wakefulness syndrome died, actually, when reassessed up to 2 years post-injury. In terms of treatments, it's now more and more admitted that patients in minimally conscious state responds much better as compared to patients who are in unresponsive wakefulness syndrome. And finally, in terms of end-of-life decision, the perception from both the medical team and the family as well is critical, and there is a clear distinction in terms of perception of the state between unresponsive wakefulness syndrome and minimally conscious state. So as I said, what is really critical to understand with patients with disorder of consciousness is that they cannot communicate. So we really lack of therapeutic strategies. We cannot do conventional physical therapy sessions with them, speech therapy session or occupational therapy session. So we kind of need to develop therapeutic approaches that do not require the patient's active participation. So as I said, there is an absence of communication, absence of interaction with the environment. Also, most of the patients, they suffer from severe motor disability, such as spasticity, which on top of the lack of communication really limits the range of movements. They are constantly bedridden. There are also a huge problem in terms of vigilance. Some patients, they have important fluctuation of vigilance, and on top of that, they may suffer from other problems such as aphasia, they can be blind or deaf. So this is all criteria that we need to take into account. So as I said, we cannot use active rehabilitation strategies with them. And this is where comes non-invasive brain stimulation. So here we will be able to really stimulate the brain without the patient's active participation. And so the first non-invasive brain stimulation that was tested with patients with disorder of consciousness is TDCS. TDCS stands for transcranial direct current stimulation. So basically, how does it work? But you this yes, you have two electrodes. I mean, now you have new tools that allows for more electrodes. There's a multi-channel stimulation, but the most common one use two electrodes, one anode and one cathode. And the anode is really increasing excitability, while the cathode, the negative one, is decreasing, or like the reference electrode, and then the current really goes from the anode here in red to the cathode here in black, and really stimulates the areas that is under the stimulating electrode, so the anode here. And through the, so it uses an electrical current, a very weak electrical current, and this electrical current can really increase the neuron excitability. So the first study that was conducted a few years ago now, so we tested the effect of TDCS. It was a single session study. So the patient received one single session of active TDCS and as well as a single session of sham TDCS as the control group. It was a crossover study, so all patients received both stimulation, active and sham. Really importantly, we did not observe any adverse event. It was really reassuring, and it was the first time we tested TDCS in a population of patients with severe brain injury. So we included 55 patients, 30 were in minimally conscious state and 25 in unresponsive wakefulness syndrome. So we did not find any effect for the patient in unresponsive wakefulness syndrome, while we did find a significant clinical effect for the patient in minimally conscious state. And this is what you can see on this box plot. So the patient in minimally conscious state gained approximately 2 points on the coma recovery scale revised, while there was no improvement after the sham stimulation. What was also very interesting is that we found that 13 out of 30 patients, so almost half of the patients, responded to the stimulation, meaning that they demonstrated a new sign of consciousness following the active stimulation, and 5 of them were in this state for more than 1 year, meaning that even at the very chronic stage, some patients can still improve and regain some sign of consciousness. So that was a very promising result for our first study. And then we also want to present you a very interesting case we had. So that's a patient, a 67-year-old woman, who was diagnosed as being unresponsive for 4 years. She was unresponsive following a subarachnoid hemorrhage. And she came to our center for a week of assessment. And so we performed 7 coma recovery scale revised assessments. So she was really assessed every day, sometimes in the morning, sometimes in the afternoon. And out of these 7 assessments, she only presented once localization to pain. So she was minimally conscious state minus, but with only a very slight sign of consciousness, a localization to pain, observed only once out of 7 assessments. It was really, really limited. And then we applied TDCS on that patient, and she demonstrated a consistent response to command following TDCS. So we were extremely surprised. We were not sure we could believe what we just saw. But then we also looked at her neuroimaging results. So when looking at her neuroimaging results, we noticed that the patient, so here you can see on the figures, on the left it's a typical unresponsive patient, on the right it's a healthy subject, and in the middle it's the patient. So as you can see, when you look at the brain metabolism assessed with the PET scan, with the PET, you see that the brain metabolism is highly preserved, not as good as in a subject, but definitely much more than in unresponsive wakefulness syndrome patients. The white matter is, as you can see here, the green tract is also very well preserved. And when we performed the active, the mental imagery task in the fMRI, she also presented some activities in response to the mental imagery task. So we really were very impressed by those results, and we were like pretty sure that this patient was much, much more conscious than what we could observe at the bedside. And then we believed what we saw, that following TDCS, yes, the patient could respond to command, as based on her neuroimaging results, it was clear that she possibly could be at least in the minimally conscious state plus, so being able to understand language, at least partially. And we saw that maybe TDCS applied over the prefrontal area may facilitate the execution of the movement, and that's why she could answer commands. So following those interesting findings, we then try to understand why some patients respond to the stimulation and why others do not. And to answer that question, as I told you, beside the clinical assessments, the patients also underwent, when they come to our center, they are also assessed with a PET scan, MRI, and high-density EEG. And what we did is that we looked at the brain metabolism, the gray matter atrophy, and the brain connectivity, and the differences between responders and non-responders. So a patient who responded to TDCS applied over the prefrontal area compared to patient who did not respond to the stimulation. And what did we find? So here that on the image on the top, you see the areas that are more preserved in responders compared to non-responders. In the image in the middle, you see the areas in blue that are atrophic in non-responders. And in red that are, sorry, more atrophic in responders. And you can see basically that non-responders have more hypometabolism and more atrophy in the stimulated area, so the left prefrontal cortex, as well as in the precuneus and the thalamus. So meaning that to respond to the stimulation, you need a preservation of the stimulated area, which is kind of obvious, but also in other critical areas for the for consciousness, which are the precuneus and subcortical regions, a critical region, the thalamus as well. And then we also looked at the brain connectivity, and we found that responders had higher connectivity in the theta banks as compared to non-responders. So theta connectivity could be seen as a biomarker of responsiveness, so patients with higher connectivity within this bandwidth may be more prone to respond to the stimulation. So what have we learned with those findings? So actually, it was kind of interesting because usually for stroke or moderate TBI, we tend to stimulate the affected hemisphere. So in stroke, usually the anode is placed over the affected motor regions, for instance, and the cathode over the unlesioned motor area. And really, the idea is really to try to stimulate the damaged brain regions. But it seems that for patients with severe brain injury and disorder of consciousness, the lesion is so big, is so important, that maybe it might be better to target at least partially preserved area, because if you put the electrode over an area that is like extremely damaged, there is no brain activity anymore, then the stimulation won't be effective at all. So following our first studies testing the effect of a single stimulation, we tried to see if TDCS could be useful when applied for a longer period of time and if the effect could last longer. And so for the study, we enrolled 16 patients in minimally conscious state, and we applied 5 sessions of TDCS once a day for 5 consecutive days. And then we looked at the effect after each stimulation session, as well as 1 week after the end of the stimulation session. And so here in blue-gray, you see the Command Recovery Scale total score after each stimulation session and 1 week after. And in black, you see the Command Recovery Scale total score after the sham stimulation. And as you can see, there is kind of a linear progression and linear increase of the Command Recovery Scale total score in the active group compared to the sham group. What was also interesting here is that some patients did not respond right away. It took them 2 to 3 stimulation sessions to show an improvement, meaning that a single stimulation is not sufficient to determine if a patient is a responder or not. So we need at least 3 stimulation sessions to determine whether a patient might respond or may not respond. We also found that we increased our number of responders, obviously, and the effects were still significantly higher as compared to baseline 1 week after the end of the stimulation session. So meaning that if you increase the number of stimulation sessions, then you increase the number of responders, but you also increase the duration of the effects. It really seems that TDCS could be used more repeatedly to induce a longer and stronger effect. And then other teams also tested the effect of TDCS, and they found similar results compared to ours. So in all of the studies, minimally conscious state patients responded better as compared to unresponsive patients. And some patients did show some improvements. However, it needs to be underlined that all the effects were usually moderate. It was really rare if a patient really responded dramatically. Most of the time, the improvements were slight. That's important. And as I said, mostly MCS patients showed improvement. So beside the prefrontal area, we also tried to see if other brain regions that are important for the recovery of consciousness could be stimulated. And here, this is a study we did in collaboration with the team of Dr. D. And here we tested the stimulation when applied over the precuneus. We know that the precuneus is a really critical hub for consciousness. But unfortunately, we did find a significant effect after 5 days of stimulation, but the improvements were way less important as compared to the stimulation when applied over the prefrontal cortex. And when we reassessed the effect at follow-up, we did not find any significant improvement anymore. So really, and the number of responders as well were lower, the rate of responders was lower for that study compared to the study where we targeted the prefrontal area. Beside the precuneus, we also tested the effect of TDCS when applied over the motor cortex using a multi-channel device. We also targeted the frontoparietal network, but so far the montage that was the most efficient was really when we target the prefrontal area. We did 3 different clinical trials, and we also had positive results. So far, at the single subject level at least, the prefrontal region seems really to be the best area to target. However, as I said, some patients, due to the brain lesion, might not respond to the stimulation when applied over the prefrontal area, and we really need to develop patient's tailored montage based on their individual brain lesion. So very quickly, I wanted to present you a very nice study that was done in collaboration with the company Cephali Technology. So here we wanted to see if TDCS could be used at home or in the patient's own environment. So we included 27 patients. The stimulation was done by the patient's caregivers or the patient's relative, such as the mother or the husband. And the compliance was really good. So the device would register all the stimulation session. And so most of the participants correctly applied the stimulation as required. However, when we look at the clinical effects, we did not find any significant improvements following the 4 weeks of stimulation. But then we saw that 5 patients did not receive correctly the amount of TDCS sessions. So 4 patients received, for instance, 1 or only 2 weeks of stimulation. And then we removed those patients from the analysis. And here we find we found a significant clinical effect after the 4 weeks of stimulation. However, when we reassessed the patient 8 weeks later, we did not find, I mean, it was only a trend, but we did not find a significant effect anymore. So meaning that to induce a clinical effect, TDCS needs to be applied constantly, I mean, repeatedly. If you stop the treatment, then the patients go back to their initial state. So that was for TDCS. Another technique is a repeated transcranial magnetic stimulation. And so here, unfortunately, up to date, there are only a couple of clinical trials that have been performed. There are a lot of open label studies and case reports, but in terms of clinical trials, only a few were done so far, or published so far. So the first one is a clinical trial where they targeted the primary motor cortex in 11 unresponsive wakefulness patients. They did not find any effect at the behavioral level nor at the neurophysiological level, which is not that surprising because we know that unresponsive patients respond way less compared to minimally conscious state patients. In another study, they looked at the effect of RTMS still applied over the primary motor cortex in a small sample of patients, 5 unresponsive with 5 minimally conscious. They did not find a behavioral improvement. However, for the group of MCS, they did find an increase in cerebral blood footfall following a single session of RTMS, which may suggest that if they would repeat the number of stimulation, this increase in cerebral blood footfall could be translated to an improvement of behavior. And finally, another study looked at the effect of 5 sessions of RTMS, but only in 3 unresponsive patients and 3 minimally conscious. And out of those 6 patients, 1 patient in minimally conscious state presented clinical improvement, but it was like such a very small sample size that it's hard to correctly interpret and generalize the results. So all those 3 studies targeted the primary motor cortex, but we saw that for TDCS, it really seems that the best area to target is the prefrontal area. And some case reports and open label studies using RTMS did target the prefrontal area, showing promising results. But those results need to be confirmed in a clinical, randomized, controlled clinical trial. So TDCS and RTMS, they're really, they can increase the excitability of cortical areas. But then there are other type of non-invasive brain stimulation that tried to reach deeper brain structures, such as the thalamus. And this is the case of LIFEP, which is low intensity focal ultrasound pulses. So it's really kind of the combination of what we can, I mean, it's non-invasive. Sorry, I will just restart. So it's non-invasive as TDCS, so it's very safe, but it's capable of stimulating the thalamus as deep brain stimulation. So here you see based on the patient's MRI, they can really target how the laser will really be oriented to target the thalamus. And this is the first report that was published in 2016 by the team of Martin Monti. It was a 20-year-old male. And so they applied ultrasound for